big things are gone. This is the bullet in Bob's arm. This is tenor sword singing. This is So Rebel.
So Rebel.
So Rebels was the second album released by the Wailers, and a turning point not just for Bob Marley and the Wailers, but for reggae music as a whole. The first long-playing record the group released was The Wailing Wailers in 1965. The album had a strong American R&B and pop influence, and even included a ska cover of What's New Pussycat. It was a collection of singles recorded and released by the group on Cox & Dodge Studio One label. However, the second album was intended to be a studio album in the more traditional sense, a body of work written with a coherent theme throughout. For that, they decided on a change of direction, and Bob approached the already renowned producer, Lee Scratch Perry. Lee Scratch Perry is often described as the Salvador Dali of music, due to his temperamental nature and bizarre manner.
Yeah! Woo-hoo! Woo-hoo!
Lee Perry started his career in the 50s as a record seller for Cox & Dodd, and worked his way up, eventually recording 30 songs for Studio One. Perry and Dodd parted ways after a series of personal and financial disagreements. Perry teamed up with Joe Gibbs in 1966 and began recording artists on a two-track tape machine at the back of Gibbs' TV repair shop. Again, financial disagreements led to Perry moving on in 1968. This time he set up his own label, Upsetter Records. The label took its name from the Lee Perry song, I Am the Upsetter, a musical insult directed at his former employer, Cox & Dodd. He put together a band for his newly formed label, The Upsetters, led by pianist Gladstone Anderson. The Upsetters recorded and released a series of singles throughout 1968, and in 1969 they released their breakout hit, Return of Django. It was released on UK reggae label Trojan Records in September and entered the UK charts at number 50. By November the 2nd, it had climbed to number 5, peaking at the same spot held by David Bowie's Space Oddity the previous week. With a single in the top 10, a tour of the UK was inevitable. However, Gladdy Anderson and the rest of the original Upsetters lineup were unavailable, so Perry drafted in newly formed group the Hippie Boys to replace them on the tour. The rhythm section of the new lineup was brothers Carlton and Aston Barrett. After returning from the UK, Lee Perry was approached by Bob Marley, who asked him to produce their next album. Marley wanted to break out of the Jamaican music scene and felt Perry, with his newfound success in Britain, was the man to help him do it. Until this point, Bob had never really expressed his Rasta beliefs on record, and the songs he wrote were mostly love songs. Lee Perry encouraged Bob to start including everything into his music. The sessions with Lee Perry began in August 1970 at Randy's Studio 17 in Kingston, as Perry didn't have his own studio yet. The first song the Wailers and Lee Perry worked on together was Soul Rebel. The sound of the recording was different from previous Wailers tracks. The recordings for Cox & Dodd featured the Studio One house band, the Soul Brothers. That was made up of ex-Scatterlite members following the breakup, and as a result featured a trademark of the Scatterlites, horns. The Lee Perry recordings featured his Upsetters band, including Carlton and Aston Barrett, who would later become the backbone of the Wailers backing band. Gone were the horns and the other frills, and instead the recordings were stripped back to just drums, bass, guitar and organ, allowing much more space for Bob, Peter and Bunny's vocals. The ska rhythms had been slowed down to the new rocksteady style that was gaining popularity, and the bass was a more prominent feature. The Wailers recorded with Lee Scratch Perry for 4 months, and many consider those tracks to be among the best Bob Marley recordings. Perry's pioneering recording techniques combined with Marley's songwriting seemed like the perfect match. Both Bob Marley and the Wailers and Lee Scratch Perry had their own record labels at this time. The Wailers had Waylon Solum Records, and Perry had Upsetter Records. But it seems they hadn't fully discussed who was going to put out this album. Without consulting Marley and the other Wailers, Lee Perry licensed the album to Trojan in the UK. The album was released in December 1970, and the members of the band don't even appear on the cover. Instead, photographer Jed Grimmel used a model dressed in army-style clothing, with her top undone, brandishing a gun. It's not known who the model is, but she appears on 6 of the 21 Trojan album covers Grimmel took the photos for. The Wailers hated the album cover, as they felt it went against their ideology. Bunny Wailer went as far as calling the photograph soft porn. Perhaps UK censors agreed. The photo was airbrushed to remove the model's nipples. Lee Perry licensing the album to Trojan without Bob Marley's knowledge caused them to fall out. Although they did record individual tracks together again, Soul Rebels was the first and only time they would make an album together. Despite that, it remains a crucial release in the evolution of reggae music and a pivotal moment for the Wailers. They found a new direction and redefined themselves as rebel music, and with the addition of Carlton and Aston Barrett, they now had the lineup that would propel them beyond the Jamaican music scene.